Good morning, Promise Youth. Happy Sunday and welcome to our Sunday service. We want to extend another warm welcoming to our sixth graders. This is their third week joining us, and we love that you are here with us. And along that line, we also want to continue to pray for our seniors who are now going to be starting their freshman year in college. And that's so exciting, so crazy, so even scary, and so we want to continue to keep them in our thoughts and prayers. And we also want to just thank you for joining us today. Wherever you are in this world, whether you're in your bed, in your living room, in your car, whether you're not even at home, whether you're in a park, we just want to just welcome and thank you for joining us today. And other than that, we don't have any announcements, and so I'm going to just be closing us in prayer. God, we just thank you so much for another opportunity, another chance to just have this virtual service, God. We want to just praise you and listen to your voice with our whole hearts today, God, that we are so blessed to be having this virtual experience for us to just be united in spirit with one another. And we want to enter worship with a heart of gratitude today. And so, God, we thank you for everything that you're doing, and that we believe that you are sovereign and that you are in control of everything that is happening in this world. And so we thank you and we praise your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
King who conquer the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. My cross. bring suffering. Lord, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so Father God, we come before you this morning confessing that you're good. You're truly good, Father. A lot of times we forget to remember, we forget to acknowledge that, we forget to live as you are so good. Not good just for our own benefits, but good just as you are, God. And Lord, we want to know that, God. So would you teach us again this morning through your servant, Pastor Stephen? And would you use your servant to bless all of us as we break this living bread, the Word of God? Thank you, Father, for this time of worship again. We pray in Jesus' name.
Good morning, Promise Youth Ministry. We have a new setting because I didn't want anything falling. And so hopefully no bloopers for us today. I want to invite us to open our Bibles to the book of Galatians. This is the new series that you and I will be venturing on for the next couple months. And we're just going to read the first 5 verses. And if you remember, in our How to Read the Bible series in epistles, we talked about every letter, every epistle, which Galatians is one, has an introduction. And so we're going to read this introduction and see how it sets up these vital truths that you and I need in the world that we live in today. And so Galatians chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. The word of the Lord, it reads, Paul, an apostle, sent not from men nor by a man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all of the brothers and sisters with me, to the churches in Galatia. Grace and peace to you from our God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Have you ever felt that you just don't measure up? Have you ever had a summer, a semester, or a year where you've made big plans for self-improvement because you felt that the state that you were in wasn't good enough? Have you ever been in a relationship, maybe with your family, maybe with your friend, or maybe even a significant other, where you felt that you simply weren't good enough, and so that you had to try harder? Have you ever been a part of a system where you felt that in order to be accepted, approved, worthwhile, and loved, that you needed to try really hard? Unfortunately, more often than not, all of us find ourselves in positions like this. And that's because we live in a world that says, if you obey, you will be accepted. Now, what do I mean by that word obey? That word obey encompasses so many things in the world that you and I live in. It's be pretty enough and you'll be accepted. Be smart enough and you'll be accepted. Be strong enough, you will be accepted. Be a certain way and then you will be accepted. And what that is essentially saying is that the way that you are right now is not worthy of acceptance, of approval, of worth, and of love. And so because of that, so many of us are trying so hard to be accepted. But what's the problem with this type of a mentality? The problem is that there will never be an enough. In a system that tells us to, if we obey, we will be accepted, we will never be able to meet that quota. Why? Well, in one part, we're going to fail. We're going to drop the ball. And you and I know this very well. We fail all the time, don't we? There are so many plans and endeavors that we have tried that don't seem to work out. There are grades that we can never seem to attain. And we live in a world where even 4.0 doesn't even seem to be enough. You need to excel past that. We're going to drop the ball. But the second issue that it poses is that because it's something that we can never attain, we'll always be enslaved to it. Now, what do I mean by that word enslaved? It means that we will suffer and live our entire lives trying to get to someplace that we can never get to. And therefore, our lies, our words, our perceptions, and our actions, they will be dictated by a standard that cannot be attained. And so you know what that does? It causes burnout. It causes anxiety. It causes depression. It causes loneliness because we feel that we can never measure up. We as beings, we as creatures, we are designed for approval, of worth, of love. We're designed for a life that is to be marked by freedom because of these things. And when we experience the absence of them, our lives fall into turmoil, chaos, and emptiness. And these are tough things for any of us to live with because these are things that we weren't designed to experience. One of my favorite examples of this has to do with monkeys. You're like, monkeys? Yeah, monkeys. There's this scientific experiment where these monkeys, after they were born by their monkeys' mothers, they were raised in this very, I don't know what the scientific word is, but this environment, this very controlled environment. And there were two fake monkey moms set up. One was set up where it's like, it was just essentially like two like robotic hands and it just gave milk. Like that's all it did. So it provided food. And the other fake monkey mom was like, it kind of looked like a monkey. It was furry and stuff, but it had like this lever that would kick. And so, but it provided no food. So like these baby monkeys would be in this controlled environment. They would have two options. This kind of robotic arm that provided food, which they need to live, or this fake monkey mom that looked like a monkey, felt like a monkey, but it had this kicking lever. And so anytime the monkeys would go to the mom-looking monkey, this robot leg would kick them. And anytime they went to the robot arm, they would get milk. Do you know which one the monkeys went to? They went to the fake monkey-looking mom that would kick them. Why? Because of their desire for approval, for affection, not simply for some type of robotic arm. And likewise, even though you and I aren't monkeys, even though we act like it sometimes, we have a need for these things. And when we don't experience them, we get crushed. And so we're always going to try to obey more, to be good enough, to be strong enough, to be pitted enough, to be better enough, to be approved. But like I said, unfortunately, this lifestyle, it only leads to slavery. But what if I told you that it didn't have to be this way? What if I told you that there was another option? What if I told you that there was another way? What if I told you that the gospel of Jesus Christ, it tells us that no, it is not obey and then you are accepted. But because of what Christ has done, you are accepted and therefore you obey. What if I told you that the good enough that you are trying to achieve, you will never measure up to it because the standard that you are looking for is perfection, and you and I cannot achieve and possibly attain perfection, not in this lifetime. What if I told you that perfection came down to you? What if I told you that it is impossible to meet the standard, and so therefore the standard came down to you? What if I told you that standard of perfection is God? And instead of you trying to find a way to him, he came down to you. And the evidence of that we have is Jesus Christ. If that news were to be true, it would have to transform and change everything, not simply about how we look and operate in the world, but even how we view ourselves. And what if I told you that there are some of us sitting here today on this Sunday who have heard the gospel and understand it in our head, but it has yet to impact the deep recesses of our heart. And so while we understand the gospel in our head, we aren't living it out because it hasn't struck down deep. But what if I told you that until that happens, you will always be operating on the system that says obey and then you will be accepted, and you'll be missing out completely on the gospel of grace that says you are accepted, therefore you will obey and you can obey. What if I told you that we as members of the church, that so many of us are recovering Pharisees? People who are trying to be good enough, to look good enough in order to be accepted. People who are trying to add on to the gospel message to our very own detriment. This is the audience that Paul is speaking to in his letter to the churches of Galatia. He's talking to believers who know the gospel and yet they aren't living it out because it hasn't struck deep within their heart. That understanding is in their head, but it hasn't transformed their lifestyle, how they view themselves and the world that they live in. And while this letter was written to the churches of Galatia thousands of years ago, I believe that its applications strike so close to the world that you and I live in today, in terms of how we view ourselves, each other, and the world that you and I live in. Because the need for the gospel, brothers and sisters, has not changed. We have not become so advanced that the gospel message is not the one truth that you and I need to hear, live, and abide by today. We need this. You know, Paul, in this introduction, he wastes no time. He wants his readers to know that he is all about the gospel and that the gospel is the message that his readers need to understand in a deep, meaningful, and rich manner. Paul makes it very clear that he has been sent not by any man, but by God himself, because he's not here to proclaim his message. Likewise, what you and I need, brothers and sisters, is not any message from man. We have a presidential election coming up, and people are under the false impression that a new president is going to come in and change everything. I assure you, it doesn't matter who we elect. It's not the message that we need. Some people believe that we need changes in our leadership, in our countries, in our communities, in the world that we live in. And while sure, those changes are necessary, they're not the long-lasting changes that we need, because no man can bring the message that can truly transform our lives. Not just 4 years, 8 years, but on an eternal scale. And Paul says this right here. The message that we need is not a message from man, but a message from God, because only God's message is the message of the gospel, which can truly free us and liberate us so that we can know what it means to be loved, to be beloved, to be cherished, and to be worthy. But what is this gospel? Paul says it right here in verses 3-5. Grace and peace to you from our God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of God, our God and Father, to whom be the glory forever and ever and ever. What is Paul saying here? Paul's saying you and I live in an age where we need to work hard and try hard in order to be accepted. But the gospel is a radically different message. It is a message that tells us that we have been accepted, not in accordance to our good works and good deeds. Because let's be honest, how good are our works and deeds? And how good can they ever be? Paul is speaking to us of a message that tells us that we are not accepted because we are worthy. Because let's face it, guys, how many of us have felt unworthy in our lives? And for some of the reasons why we feel unworthy, it's not valid, but some of them, they really are. We've failed ourselves. We've let down the people that we love. We've even let down strangers. We've let down leaders. We've let down the people in our lives. We're not the most worthy of beings. But Paul speaks of a message that tells us that our worth and our acceptance do not come by our good deeds, but come because Jesus Christ gave himself up in accordance to our sins because we needed rescuing. Paul speaks to us of a gospel that looks at us exactly as we are, knowing that we are people in need of rescue, that we cannot rescue ourselves, but we have a God who does. Paul, in his introduction, invites us to uncover the deep and profound truth of the gospel. And so likewise, this is the journey that I want us to take together as a youth ministry. Maybe for some of you, if I asked you to define the gospel, you would have no place to start. You wouldn't know how to define it. And if that's you, join us on these Sundays so we can know what the gospel really means. Maybe for some of you, you can define it, but your struggle is that you don't know how to live it. And because you don't know how to live it, your life has not been marked with fullness, but it's been marked with emptiness. If that's you, I invite you to join us on these Sundays as we uncover the book of Galatians together. And maybe for some of you, you once knew it and you once lived it. But in the age that you and I have lived in, you've forgotten it. You once knew how sweet the gospel is. You once knew what it meant to live a gospel-centered life. You once knew what it meant to see the gospel transform your mind, your heart, your spirit, and your world. But you've just forgotten. And somewhere along the path, you got lost. If that's you, I want to invite you back. Because I know that the Spirit of God is inviting you back. And through this journey, through the book of Galatians, I want us as a youth ministry to know the gospel and to be transformed by the gospel, because it is the news that you and I need. So starting from this week on, guys, this is going to be our journey. Our journey to be a people who don't operate by the standard of obey, therefore you are accepted. But for us to be a people who operate on the standard of you are accepted and therefore obey. And through this, guys, we are going to see how the gospel literally changes everything. I, for one, am excited because I need this. I'm excited for us because I know that we need this. And I'm excited because I know that God is going to take us to places that you and I can't even begin to imagine right now. And so as Paul invites the churches of Galatians to reclaim a fresh understanding of the gospel, I want to invite us to do the same. This is our goal and this is our journey. And so let's pray into it. Let's lean into it. Let's fight for it. Let's yearn for it. And together we can once again become a gospel-centered people and a gospel-centered ministry. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. And I thank you specifically for this new journey that we're going to go through the book of Galatians, as we uncover what it means to live gospel-centered lives, to live not lives based on work, but lives based on grace, Lord, because it is your grace that we need. And so, Lord, would you uncover these truths that our hearts long for? Would you uncover these truths that we are desperate for, God? Because we need you now more than ever. So I thank you. And in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Alrighty, guys. Let's get after it. I'll see you guys next week. Bye-bye.